So this is the thing we are going to cover today. So we'll cover a little bit of review of whatever we have talked so far in KNN, and similarly some more concepts which we have not covered in artificial neural network. We'll be doing that. After that, we'll see the code as to how to train our first neural network, so first artificial neural network to train and solve the MNIST use case. So we know what is the MNIST dataset, right? 0 to 9 digits. So we are going to do that. And once that is done, we'll go to the interesting part, which is like the introduction to CNN, which is the premier most algorithm for solving image related use cases, and similarly speech related use cases as well. So yeah, we will go to that interesting part. We'll see what are the structural components that are present in CNN, and what are the important topics that are related to CNN. So this is the agenda for today. So yeah. Okay, yeah, someone is asking like, what is learning rate? So learning rate is the pace at which the network learns. So say that you have started from a particular point, you're learning at a particular point, and we try to reduce the loss, right? So we have discussed about this yesterday, like we start the weight initialization with some random weights at the beginning. Once that is done, you will be getting some certain loss, and you try to reduce that loss by moving in a particular direction using gradient descent. That is what we do, right? So what we see is once we know what is the direction we need to move in, we need to understand like how much fast we need to move in that direction. So either you can move very fast, or you can move very slow, or you can go at the optimal pace. So that is something which can be configured. So if you're going at a very slow pace, right, it is possible that it will take a lot of time before you reach the global minima. And if you are going at a very high pace, it might be possible that you can actually overshoot the global minima and or any minima, and you can actually not converge at all. So these are the two kinds of issues that are there. Obviously, the second one is kind of very bad, that you have overshot and have not even, there is no option to reach the converge to the minima. But at least the other one is fine, even if it is slow. You are actually reaching the minima, right? But still, there is a lot of wastage of your time and similarly the computational resources. So that is also not very good. Ideally, what would be good is like if you are going at the optimal learning rate. The optimal learning rate, how do you know what is the optimal learning rate? You try to figure out different learning rates and see whether the loss is converging or not. If the loss is converging, try to increase the learning rate and see if the loss is still converging. If it is not converging and it is diverging, it means that you are using a higher learning rate, then you can reduce it. This is how you can tune. We have seen that hyperparameter tuning is the task of a machine learning engineer, right? So yeah, learning rate is one very important hyperparameter as well for you to reach that minima, that is get the best accuracy. Is it clear what learning rate is, Sagar? Okay, great. So someone yet has mentioned yesterday that why not we start with a higher learning rate at the beginning and then reduce the learning rate as we reach the end. So that is a very valid point. We'll see that we will be actually doing that as a technique in the next class, I guess. So we will talk about learning rate scheduling, where we start with a higher learning rate and we gradually reduce the learning rate as we train, so that we converge better. So we have talked about what is a batch. Batch is nothing but a set of images in the case of, in our use case. So for example, if we are having 60,000 images in our data set, right, we don't want to actually throw all 60,000 images at the neural network at once, because it will lead to your computer crashing, because it can't handle that many amount of images at the same time. So what we do is we try to divide it into batches of images and provide those one after the other. So this concept of training on a batch of images is called a mini batch gradient descent, right? So we have seen what is the difference between stochastic gradient descent, mini batch gradient descent, and batch gradient descent. So stochastic is when you are passing an image one by one. Mini batch is when you are passing passing batch of images, and batch gradient descent is when you are passing all the images at once. And we saw that we generally use mini batch gradient descent in general. Right. And yeah, so we have talked about what is the batch, batch size is the parameter. This is again a hyperparameter. So what we say is like how many images to keep in a batch. Should we keep 5 images? Should we keep 10 images? Should I keep 100 images? It is configurable. So a human actually can change that and see which one is actually giving better results. Sometimes you see that if you actually keep a very low batch size, it will take a lot of time. And if you keep a very high batch size, it will be computationally expensive, right? So you need to figure out what is the ideal optimal batch size. And also you will see that there is a very good interesting property of mini batch gradient descent. We saw that yesterday there is a possibility of neural network getting stuck in local minima, if you remember, right? That is possible because at local minima, if you go left or even if you go right, it is not a better point than the current position. So that's why it is difficult once you get to a local minima to come out from that. But what happens is when you use mini batch gradient descent, right, it is possible that you might not actually get stuck in local minima. Why is that so? That is because when you are actually going across the curve like this, right? So mini batch gradient descent, we know that it doesn't actually go in a straight direction. It actually had a little bit of zitter. If you see this figure, right? So if you see this figure, we know this is the batch gradient descent. It goes in a straight direction. Stochastic gradient descent is a very drunkard person. It goes in all directions and it might reach or it might not reach at the end. Hopefully it reaches. But mini batch gradient descent is a trade-off between these two. So it acts a little bit drunk, but ideally it performs much better than stochastic gradient descent and it goes to the right point. But what happens is since it's not going in straight path, right? So sometimes there are oscillations. So sometimes it might not go in the right path. It might deviate a little bit, but it will correct itself and come back again after some time. So because you can think of it like a noise. It is not going in the straight path. So there is a like a disturbance in the ball. Like what we are comparing this phenomenon is to a ball which is dropped on a mountain, right? If you remember, we compared it to that analogy that we have dropped a ball on a mountain and we are seeing how the ball behaves. How does it go downward? So because we have this kind of mini batch gradient descent, right? It will not always go down. Sometimes it will go up. Sometimes it might go down. So this kind of thing can happen. It will not always go in one direction because of this mini batch gradient descent. Every batch you are getting a different kind of image, right? One batch might say that you need to go down. Another batch of images might say that you need to go up. Yeah, so we are dropping ball at every batch of images. Yes, in mini batch, it is like for every batch of images, we see which direction the ball has to go. So one batch might say that you need the ball has to go downward. The other batch might say that no, actually it's not downward. It should go upward because the data is different across batches, right? One batch will have maybe digits 3 and digits 5, but other batch had like digits 1 and 6. So these kind of differences are there because of that one batch is not similar to other batch. And that is why you might actually get a different signal in every batch saying that you need to do this, do that. Because of that, there is a little bit of noise. And due to this noise, it doesn't go the straight path and it actually zitters a bit. So that is what we have seen in mini batch gradient descent. And why is this zitter good? So this zitter is good because if you are stuck in a local minima, right, this zitter can actually help you sometimes to overshoot this. So when you have this kind of zitter, right, sometimes this zitter, what it does is it will not let you stay in a point. Sometimes what it will do is it will let you overshoot this local minima. So there is a possibility because we are not actually going in only one direction, even after you have come here. The next batch might say that no, you are not in the right position. You need to actually go up. And because it goes up, it can happen that it can cross this point and it can again dip over to a better minima, which is the global minima here, right? So that is why mini batch gradient descent is better because it adds that little bit of noise, which helps you overcome the local minima and lets you go to global minima, right? Is this clear why mini batch gradient descent helps you to some extent to not get stuck in local minima? Right, so someone was asking what are the different techniques that are used. I mean, someone posted in WhatsApp group asking like what are the different various techniques which can be used to solve this task of we getting stuck in local minima. So this is one technique. We will discuss more other techniques as well, but yeah. Anytime you want to solve this problem of local minima, what you do is you try to add some kind of a noise. So so that the ball doesn't settle immediately. If it settles immediately, it will get stuck in one point. But if we don't let the ball settle, right, it will not get stuck in points where there is a point of getting disturbed and going to a better point, right? So that's why we add noise whenever possible. So batch mini batch gradient descent is one way of doing it. We'll discuss other techniques also later. So when training the neural network, right? So whenever you are training a neural network, what you do is you train it on set of images. But what might happen is the neural network actually learned only those images. And if I give a new image which is not there in the data set, it might not perform better. So this is similar to how a student who does rote learning, who mugs up the answers, performs in an exam. So if he have he had mugged up all the answers and he went to the exam and he got a question which he had never seen, but it is related to the questions that he had studied, but only like a slight variation of the question, right? So if he has seen that kind of a question in exam, he is not prepared. He has no idea because it doesn't match any of the questions that he has read during his preparation. So what happens is he will stumble and he will not perform good. So that is the same kind of thing that can happen to a neural network as well. So if it performs only on the data that it is seen properly, and if you give another image which is kind of a slight variation of the input, so maybe I will maybe slightly turn the 7 or something like that. I give a very slight variation to the input, and if the neural network is not able to classify it as the right proper image, right, that means that neural network is a magu. It is not performing well. It has just by-hearted all the images. So that is not what we want. So this kind of thing which can happen is called overfitting. Overfitting means it has overly fitted to the data set that we have provided. It has overly learned the data set we have provided, and it has no idea how it is working. It has just only kept in memory that if this kind of image comes, I need to give this kind of output. That's it. It has no idea of the internal structures to understand how to actually do that classification. This is similar to when you do a rote learning, right? You just by-hearted the answer, but you had no idea of like how to construct the answer. Same thing is happening in the case of neural network as well. It has no idea of like figuring out how to do the classification of a particular digit. It just has by-hearted saying that if I am giving this input, I will give this output. We don't want that kind of a scenario to happen. And this kind of scenario happens a lot. So we have to deal with this. So there are many techniques to deal with this. Those are called regularization techniques. We'll be talking about them. But before going to those, we need to actually test out if our neural network is actually a magu or not. So how we do that? We do that by dividing the data set that we are given into two parts, the training part and the test part. So if I'm given 60,000 images, right? So what I will do is I'll divide it into 50,000 images and another set of 10,000 images. The first 50,000 images, I use it for training the neural network. The other 10,000 images, right? I will never show it to the neural network. So the neural network has never seen them. Now I test the neural network on these 10,000 images, which it has never seen. And I try to gauge the results. If it is performing well, that means that it is not a magu. It has not overfitted. But if it is not performing well, it means that it has only learned the data set that we have provided. So we need to do something to make it learn and generalize, right? So this is the problem of overfitting. So this is a very fundamental question that is asked in interviews. So whenever you go to an interview, someone will ask what is underfitting, what is good fit or robust fit, and what is an overfitted model. So overfitted model is something like a magu we have discussed. Underfitted model is if it doesn't have the capability to do the task, right? It is an underfitted model. So it can't actually reach 90% accuracy. It will get stuck at something like a 50% accuracy. That is called underfitting. It doesn't have the capability to do the task. But if it has overly fitted to the trained data set and it is not working better on the test data set, it means that it has a overfit model. A good fit is one which performs as good on the training data set as the test data set. So if it is able to like give comparable results on both the training data set and test data set, right? It means that it has generalized how to do this particular task of classification. So ideally, we want to be in that position. We want a good fit. Is this clear? What is a underfitting, overfitting, and similarly good fit? How about others? Okay, great. So yeah, so that is how we test underfitting or overfitting. One more thing to add before actually giving the network input, right? What we do is we normalize the input. By normalization, what I mean is I have said that we can actually, the pixel values, right? It is between 0 to 1, but in real world, they are not between 0 to 1. You see that pixel values are between 0 to 255. If you see any pixel value in an image. So it will have a value between 0 to 255. So we need to normalize it to be between 0 to 1. So what we do is we divide every pixel value by 255 before passing it to the neural network so that every pixel value will stay between 0 to 1. Right? So that is the input normalization. That is one training technique as well. We'll see all these training techniques when I will be talking about, when I will be showing the example of code for solving a use case of MNIST. So, let's do that. Now I'll be talking about a particular example of solving the task of classification. So I'll be sharing a Google Colab link. I mean, I'll be showing the code on the Google Colab link. I'll share the notebook so you can try it out. And yeah. Currently, I have given an example of where we have reached 96% accuracy. So I will ask you to try and improve the network. So your task is to take the code and try to improve the network doing a lot of hyperparameter tuning. So we have talked about various hyperparameters, right? Both the batch size, learning rate, number of hidden layers, and number of neurons in a particular hidden layer and all these things. So you'll use all these techniques to try and improve the accuracy. So yeah, you can do that after the class. But yeah, now I'll just give a glimpse of how the code looks like when you are creating a neural network. So I guess everyone is able to see my code, right? So this is the data set we are going to use. It is called MNIST. It is handwritten digits data set. So you already had an idea of what is it. So we have handwritten digits of 0 to 9, which we will be classifying using our neural network. So we are using Keras, TensorFlow Keras. That is what we'll be using here. So we are loading the data set from Keras and we are doing it. So it gives us both the training and testing. Yeah, so I'll be sharing the Google Colab link in WhatsApp. So yeah, why Keras? Actually, the code is kind of similar to Keras. We can use TensorFlow only. So the code is kind of similar. I just used one of my old examples, but yeah, we can convert it into TensorFlow. It will almost look similar, not much of a difference, but yeah. This is just to give a demonstration of how neural network looks like, but yeah, we can change it to TensorFlow. It should not be very tough of a task because the syntax is almost the same. So we are loading the data. So when we load the data, we have got both the training and test data. So we have seen that we need to divide it into train and test, right? To see if it is actually performing well on images that it has not seen. So MNIST, when you do MNIST.load data, it gives us both of that. And similarly, it also gives y-train and y-test. So x-train and x-test are the images. So we had 60,000 images. It will divide it into 50,000 train and 10,000 test images, and it will give you. And y-train and y-test will be the outputs. So outputs will be, you know, right, the labels of the images. So if you are given a digit 2, the output of that will be 2, number 2, integer 2. So you are stored all those values in y-train and y-test. So I don't know what is Keras layer score. Is it present in this part of code you are saying, or you are asking in general? Abhishek, are you asking Keras dot layer score is something in general, or like is it present in? Oh, this is there in this code. Which part? I don't see it. Okay, layers.core. Okay. Yeah, got it. So yeah, in Keras, so we have a lot of layers. So what happens is we have seen yesterday that a neural network has different kinds of things going on. So you have a fully connected neural network, right? So you can actually directly import fully connected neural network and connect, create it. So dense means that. So when you do keras.layers.core import dense, right? You are getting an option to import the dense layer. By dense layer, what I mean is a fully connected layer. Similarly, there is something called as dropout, which I'll discuss later. It is a regularization technique to make the neural network perform better on test data set. And then there is an activation layer. Activation, we know what is activation, right? So activation makes the creates the non-linearity into the neural network, and also it can actually do a lot of do things like constraining the output and things like that. If it is sigmoid, in ELO it doesn't constrain, but yeah, in general I'm saying. So what will be that ratio of training and test data? So you can define it, since this is already available data set, right? We have not done that, but in general it will be 80 to 20%. So 80 train and 20 test. We don't want to actually remove a lot of data set from training, because if we remove a lot of data set from train and keep it in test, right, we will not actually expose our neural network to a lot of data. And there is this thing that a neural network needs a lot of data for it to perform and give better results, unlike machine learning. So yeah, that is why deep learning needs a lot of images compared to machine learning. So this is one kind of problem with deep learning, which is solved though. It is solved through a technique called transfer learning. We are not talking about it now because it is outside of the scope of this course. But yeah, you can change that. You can make 80-20 become 70-30 or something like that as well, based on whatever your interest is. So it is not predefined. In this case, it is predefined, but not always. So here we are not mentioning it because we are directly taking the MNIST dataset using a wrapper that is present in keras.datasets. That's why we are not mentioning it. But if you are loading an image from your disk, right? So if you are loading it from your C drive or something like that and into the memory, there you can mention, like, out of the 60,000 images that you're loading from the disk, divide it into this much range, 70-30 or whatever. So it is a preferred rule, 80-20, something like that, but you can change it. You can make it 70-30, 90-10 based on whatever you want to. Here we are not doing it because MNIST by default use only 80-20. Yeah, so someone is asking, is it similar to TensorFlow? Actually, it is almost the same. TensorFlow will look like this as well. So I'll share the TensorFlow example later as well if you are interested in working on TensorFlow, but there is not much of a difference. So these are the digits. So this is just some way to plot it. So you can ignore all this filler. This is just to actually show how the data set looks like. So yeah, these are few samples from the data set, digit 50 and all those things. These are handwritten digits. So someone has sit down and written all these digits. So when you do dot shape, right, it will tell you what is the shape of the vector or tensor, you can say. So in this case, it says that there are 60,000 images in my train data set and 10,000 images that is present in test data set. Right? So that is what is the distribution of images. So there are 60,000 images present in my train and 10,000 images present in test. And also every image is of 28 cross 28 pixels, right? We have seen that. So that is why 28 cross 28 is 784. So this is the shape, 60,000 images each of having 784 shape, right? So that is the shape of train. And similarly for test, it is 10,000 images is each of having 784 shape. We are going to use float 32. We are not going to use integer because you know, right? Float is more capable than integer. You can if you are using only integer, right? Or if you haven't done this kind of thing, what happens is it can think of it like you need to use only integers. That will make your network perform well below par. So you need to do this before you start training, so that all the values that are present in your neural network, right, be it weights or be it biases or be it the input values, all these are present as float values and not like integer values. We saw that we need to normalize the inputs. This is one thing why we do, is because if the values are between 0 to 1, network actually can train faster, because the calculations are simpler to do rather than if the values are greater than or not between 0 to 1. So that is one reason why we do. Another reason is like we wanted to keep all of them between one range rather than having different values present across. So this is one normalization. There are many other normalization techniques as well. Probably we'll see them later, but for this example, we are going to go with this normalization. We saw that pixel values vary between 0 to 255, right? That's why we are doing division by 255. When you do division by 255, all the values will be constrained between 0 to 1. So yeah, the matrix size is 60,000 cross 784. That is what the matrix or tensor size is, that 60,000 images, each of having 784 values. So we have converted it into a 1D vector. So we have seen that image is there, right? Although image is 2D because it has both width and height, to give it to a network, we need to convert it into 1D. So what we have done is we have taken all the pixels and ordered, kept them on a linear line. So we have got 784 values like that. That is how we have provided input, if you remember, right? So we took every pixel value and provided it as an input to the neural network. So there are 784 nodes. So that is how we have converted a 2D image into a 1D vector, which can be provided as input to the neural network, if you remember, right? And what is the output that is given to you, right? It is not one hot encoded. So we do one hot encoding. We know what one hot encoding, right? So say our outputs are between 0 to 9 and I'm given a label 3. Neural network doesn't understand what is 3. We need to give it in the type of which node will get activated. So to say that third node will be activated, right? Not third node, fourth node will be activated, because we start from 0, right? So we need to say that I'll give this kind of an output. So this is one hot encoding. I have converted a number 3 into a one hot encoded vector. Because there are 10 values, so there will be 10 values in the output. That is what I am showing. And we are supposed to have an output of 3. So that's why I am going to highlight the fourth node. So we start from 0, 1, 2, 3. So fourth node is the value 3. We are going to make it 1 and rest all 0. That is how you convert a label into a one hot encoding vector. So, and we need to provide that to our neural network. Same thing we are doing here. So the labels that we are given, right, y-train and y-test, they are given in this format. So we'll be given values like 0 to 9. We want to convert it into one hot encoding vector. So you do that using this function and putils.to categorical. So it will convert it into that one hot encoding vector. So now we have come to a stage where we can define the neural network. So we are going to use a sequential API of Keras. So sequential API works like this. So sequentially, we give every layer one after the other, and it will form the neural network that way. So I'm defining the model. Model equals to sequential of. So I have created an empty neural network. Now I am adding it as a dense layer with the 512 nodes in it and input size of 784. So what it does is, when you keep input shape of 784, right? So it already created 784 input nodes, right? So on top of that one, it created another hidden layer, which is having 512 input nodes. So that is how you give the first input. The first input, you are saying that, I mean, this is almost like the first hidden layer. So I'm saying I'm creating a hidden layer with 512 nodes. By nodes, I mean neurons. We have seen how it looks like, right? Every hidden layer. So I have kept 512 hidden neurons in the first layer, and then it has an input of size 784. We know what is the input, that is the input coming from the image, which is of shape 28 cross 28. That's why 784. So I'm creating 512 nodes in my first hidden layer. And I'm saying that I'll be using activation function ReLU. You can use some other activation function as well. So we know that we saw that ReLU performs better than other activation functions. So yeah, we saw that for one image, we have 784 inputs, right? An image is nothing but 28 cross 28 vector. Sorry, 28 cross 28 matrix. If you remember, we have talked about it, right? In our case, for our data set of MNIST, every image is 28 cross 28 resolution image. 28 cross 28 is nothing but 784 values, 784 pixels. Every pixel is one input. So that's why we have 784 inputs. Yeah, so it will learn for all 60,000 images. So we'll be passing all the images batch by batch. So we'll be mentioning the batch size below. But yeah, this is how it works. You're defining the input size to be 784. That means there will be 784 input nodes. So and then I'm creating a hidden layer of 512 nodes. So why we have used 512, Jashandeep is asking. So there is no reason why I have used 512. You can use some other number as well and see if it is giving better results. I have just randomly cut 512. But you can try out and see, maybe 10, 100, 1000, you can try out anything and see which one is giving better results based on that, that you can keep. And we are using activation. We know that whatever the output that is coming from the node, we pass it through an activation to say whether it is activated or not, right? So we are using an ReLU activation. So I have not talked about dropout. That's why I have not I have commented it out for now. We'll talk about what is dropout next. Then we have another hidden layer, which is having 784 nodes connecting to the previous hidden layer, right? Again, it is passed through activation ReLU. And then I have another hidden layer, which is having 128 nodes, and it is connected again going through activation ReLU. So I'm done with my network. I have come to output layer. I know that output is supposed to have 10 outputs, right? So I'm creating another hidden layer, another layer with 10 nodes. So this is my output layer. And we know that we need to pass it through an activation softmax, because at the output we need a probability. So that's why we are passing it through softmax activation function. So this is how I created my neural network with three hidden layers, one input layer and one output layer. That is how you create a neural network in TensorFlow Keras. Is that clear? How we are defining the neural network and what are the components that are present? So dense is nothing but fully connected, as we have seen. So what it will do is it will connect every node from the previous layer with every other node in the next layer. So that's why we imported both these dense and activation layers from Keras.layers. Someone was asking what is that. So we need to import that. And dense is saying, by dense, what we mean is it is fully connected. The number of neurons is mentioned here. So 512 is the number of neurons. It is the parameter of dense. By dense, what it means is it will connect every neuron to every other neuron from its previous layer. So there are 784 input nodes, right? So it will connect every node of this 784 to every node in this 512 hidden layer. So that is what dense is. Dense means it is fully connected. Similarly, when you say dense here, so what it says is it connects every hidden layer node in second layer with every hidden layer node in first layer. So dense and fully connected, you can actually use interchangeably. So we have created our neural network. So we are going to use cross entropy loss. We have seen that we need to actually define a loss function for it to train properly. So we have to define it. We are using stochastic gradient descent. Although the name is stochastic gradient descent, it is actually happening batch gradient descent, because we'll see, we mentioned batch below. So there is this concept of optimizer. Optimizer tells you how do you go and which direction to take. So we know that we have seen gradient descent is the one which does it, right? So that is the optimizer here. So there are other optimizers as well apart from gradient descent, like Adam optimizer and others. So we'll talk about them probably later. But yeah, optimizer is the gradient descent technique that we have discussed yesterday, which will tell you which way to go forward and how to go forward. So someone is asking why the number of hidden neurons are present more in second layer than first layer. So there is no case that it has to be more or less. You can try out which one is working and which gives better results. I just kept randomly some number of nodes. You can actually keep less, you can keep more, and see which one is giving better results. That one will work for you. And one thing is, if you keep more number of nodes, right, the network will become beefier. And if it becomes beefier, it becomes slow to train because it will be having more number of weights now, right? So that is a problem. And if it is less, it might have very less capability to do the task. So you need to adjust in between this, not make it very beefy and not make it very small that it can't do the task. So we are running a model.fit. So what this does is it will try to fit on the training data set. So we are giving X train and Y train. I'm saying batch size is 128. So what it will do is it will take 128 images at once and pass through the network, get 128 outputs and change weights based on that. So this is the mini batch gradient descent. Someone is asking the number of neurons in input and output layer depends upon our data set. Exactly. So it depends upon our data set. In our data set, every image is of size 28x28. That's why the number of input nodes are 784. In our output, there are 10 nodes because our data set had only 10 classes. So batch size is one hyperparameter, right? Again, I have kept 128 here. You can change it and see which one is actually giving you better results. You try lower batch size, you try higher batch size and see which one is giving you better results. That is something you can change as well. And how do we decide the number of hidden layers? Again, this is something you need to do trial and error. So I have kept only 3 hidden layers. You can actually keep another hidden layer. You can remove one hidden layer. That is something left to you, how many hidden layers you want to keep. So the number of hidden layers to keep and number of neurons that needs to be kept in every hidden layer, these are all things that is something you need to decide. Yeah, more layers lead to overfitting, true. Because why is the reason more layers lead to overfitting? Because when you are adding more layers, you are actually getting more weights. And when you are getting more weights, what happens is you are actually increasing the capacity of the neural network. So it can actually overfit and not learn properly. So there are techniques to find the ideal number of layers, but for most of them are actually defined for CNN because ANN performs poorly for many other use cases. So we don't actually do a lot of this. So for ANN, you can actually do it trial and error and see which one is giving you better results. But there are not a lot of techniques. We'll see a lot of techniques in CNN though. So someone is asking, what is epoch? Epoch is when you complete all the images that are present in a data set. So we know that we have actually divided our data set into batches and we are sending all the batches one by one, right? So when you are having 60,000 images, what you do is you divide it into batches of image set size 28. So you'll be having 60,000 by 128 batches, right? You pass all these batches one by one. And once everything is done, you call it an epoch. So it means that your neural network has seen all the images at least once. All the batches have been passed through the network once. What we will see is a neural network actually needs to look at the data set multiple times for it to be getting better results. I'll tell what is verbose, but let me complete what is epoch. So epoch is when you, a lot of questions looks like, great. So it's good to see a lot of people are interested. So epoch means that when a neural network has gone through all the images at once, it is called an epoch. Right? Is this clear? What is an epoch? So if you are having 60,000 images, you are having 60,000 by 128 batches. So 60,000 by 128, I don't know, maybe it will come to around some 50 batches, I guess. Not 50, 500. 500 batches. Some nearly 500 batches. So once you are done with all these 500 batches, it is called an epoch. Right? So why do we need epoch? Because we need to train the neural network multiple times. Just showing all the images once for the neural network is not required, not enough. So we need to make the neural network learn multiple times. So we'll show all the images multiple times to the neural network. So once we have shown all the images to the neural network at once, right, what we'll do is we'll report the process. We'll start from the again beginning and we'll show all these 500 batches again. Yeah, so after completing 500 batches, we are getting one epoch completed. And once this is done, we again start training on those 500 batches again. So we continue this process as many number of times as possible. So in this case, we actually have 20 epochs. That means that we are doing it for 20 times. Yes. So yeah, epoch is some. Like times the neural network has seen the entire data set. Do epoch refine our results? Yes. So what we see is when you actually train the neural network first time on first epoch, right, you will not get the best accuracy. You need to actually train it for at least few number of epochs before it gets to a decent amount of accuracy. So the longer you train it, the best accuracy you can get. But what you see is after training for few epochs, right, it kind of saturates. There will not be a lot of improvement. Either it will just oscillate a little bit in that point. So this is like dropping a ball, if you remember, right? So we are doing the same thing, but after reaching that global minima, it will not change a lot. It will just oscillate a little bit over there and again get saturated there only. So the accuracy won't change. So we are trying to do that. Once we see that the accuracy is not changing, right, we'll stop. So that is how we train the neural network. We train it for few epochs, see how the accuracy is changing. If it is not improving, that means that our neural network has converged. This actually doesn't work for machine learning. In machine learning, you don't actually show the data set multiple times to the whatever algorithm. You show only once. Neural network is kind of different. That's why it takes more time to train. Deep learning takes more time to train than machine learning. Any question I missed? So yeah, someone is asking, is there any method to divide data for train and test? Yeah, it is possible. Currently in this, the data set is given to us in a spoon. That's why we are not doing it. But if you have created a data set yourself and you want to divide it for train and test, right, you can divide it in some ratio, Alex. Is this clear, all the concepts that we have discussed so far, batch size, epoch? Someone asked, what is verbose? Verbose is nothing. It is a argument we gave so that it will actually print some information on the console and we will know what is going on. Verbose means it will give some debug logs. That's it. So it will contain the history of your entire training. So you can actually plot it. That is what your history contains. So once the training is done, right, you wanted to see like how the accuracy is improving across every epoch, right? So what happens is sometimes you have got the best accuracy at epoch 12, and after that your neural network actually became worse, and by epoch 20 you are not getting the best accuracy. So say you got 99.9 accuracy at epoch 12, and by epoch 20 you have got 99.4, right? You don't want that to actually happen. So what you can do is you can take the neural network at epoch 12 and use that for your use case rather than something which is present at 19 epoch 20. So that's why you need history kind of thing to see how your accuracy and error was varying across. So what kind of ratio? So the ratio is, again, like as we have discussed, it is something that you need to fix, but most generally it is 80 to 20. So 80% of the data set is in train and 20% of the data set is in test. Yeah, so for every epoch, you will have different history, because for every epoch, you'll be getting different results, right? You'll be getting a different accuracy. So all the epoch history is stored in that history variable. So we have started, you can see that in the first epoch, we have about 88.28 accuracy, and slowly it is improving a little bit, and afterwards it will get saturated. So it got saturated around some 96%. There is still a chance to improve it. I have stopped it because I just wanted to stop it. But you are supposed to train it. I will share this code with you. You need to train this and make it come to at least 97%, 98% accuracy. So yeah, I will share this notebook with you. You go on, change all the hyperparameters that I have mentioned and see which one is working for you. So I'm plotting the using the history. I'm just plotting. So this gives me an idea whether how is my accuracy and error are present for train and test. So that is why this history variable is required, sort of someone asked, right? So there is another parameter, learning rate, which I missed out. So probably you can add it yourself. I have not added it here. So if you want to use that also, you can add it. Or if not, it's okay as well. Is this clear? The entire code part, how we are training a neural network and getting the accuracy results. So I'll be sharing the notebook with you. Go through it and try to better the accuracy. So we'll see what is the highest accuracy we'll get in this batch. So I'll be sharing the notebook. So everyone, what you will do is you report your results in the WhatsApp group, what accuracy you are getting whenever you have trained the network, so that everyone can see and try to improve their results as well. So we'll try to see what is the highest accuracy we can get. So try out different kinds of hyperparameters. We have seen batch size, we have seen the number of hidden layers, number of hidden nodes, and similarly learning rate, which I have not mentioned here, but go for that also. Use all these to try to get the best accuracy. There should be some tool to make you look at the neural network diagram. Currently, I don't have it, so you can't directly see it, but there should be some tools which actually visualize the neural network. I'll see if I can actually find out a tool which can do that. Generally, we don't do that because we know how it looks like. What we do is we do something like model.summary, which will give you an idea of how it's gonna look like. So probably I can show that part. So when you do model.summary, it will give you all the layers that are present. So it will say that you have first hidden layer, dense layer, it has 12 nodes, and then you have an activation. And then another dense hidden layer, which is a hidden layer with 784 nodes and activation dense, dense activation. So this is the schematic which we use to see how the neural network looks like. But I will check if there is any tool which actually gives you an idea how to show it like a graph. So in this, you also can see like how many parameters are there. The parameters signifies how many weights are there in this neural network. So you can see that it has 9 lakh weights, which is a huge number. You can probably reduce it as well. We don't need that many number of weights to do a task like MNIST classification. I would just randomly put a huge number of hidden nodes. That's why it's taking that much. But ideally, you can reduce it a lot. Okay, I hope all these concepts are clear. If so, I'll go and start the remaining things. Okay, great. So we'll talk about what is dropout. So dropout is a regularization technique. We have seen that regularization techniques are used to combat overfitting to make the neural network generalized. So dropout is one of the regularization techniques. There are many other techniques as well, which we'll discuss probably tomorrow. I mean, not tomorrow, whenever the next class is. But yeah, we'll get started with what is dropout. So what dropout does is, if you have a neural network like this, right? You see that every neuron is connected to every other neuron. So this is a fully connected neural network. So this is how a standard neural network looks like. So when you apply dropout, what it does is it will randomly drop some of the nodes in every layer. So you can see that in the first two layer, the second and third nodes are randomly dropped. So all the connections related to it are also not available. In the second hidden layer, so first, third and fourth nodes are randomly dropped. And then the third one, second and fourth nodes are randomly dropped. So this is what happens when you apply dropout. It will randomly drop few nodes in a neural network. And it does this for one particular iteration. So for one batch, it does this. For the next batch, what it does is it will drop another set of hidden nodes, not this set. So it will reactivate this set and it will drop another random set. So every batch, you will see random number of hidden nodes getting dropped. So that way you will see that the neural network structure will not remain constant. It will change every time for every batch, right? So maybe in the first case, I have dropped the second and third node, right? In the second batch, I will probably drop first and fourth node. So this kind of thing happens across every batch. Yeah, so pretty good question. What if imported nodes are dropped? That is what we are trying to combat. So if some imported node is dropped, there should be another imported node which should take care of doing the task of that imported node. We are actually trying to do that with the help of dropout. What we are trying to say is, say, compare it to, like, there is a hero in the movie who has to destroy the villain. Hero in this case is the neural network, and villain is completing the task of image classification. So the neural network wants to do that task. So like hero defeating the villain. So what happens is, even if the hero is one arm is down, removed or something like that, he should still be able to go and kill the villain, right? He should be that powerful that even if all the odds are against the hero, he should be still be able to go and kill the villain. Or if you have seen a running competition of hero and villain, it happens that some obstacle comes to hero and he will get stopped in the middle. So those kind of obstacles comes, but still he wins at the end, right? So what we are trying to say is, we are trying to make the network robust, saying that even if there are any kind of uncertainties that is present, even if one kind of node doesn't work, there should be another node which should take care of this and make it work. So even if one important node is dropped, there should be another important node which should help in completing the task of image classification. So that is what dropout does. So someone is asking how it is decided which node should be dropped. Yeah, good question. So how we do that is we do it through randomness. So we say that, define in our neural network saying that at every layer, drop randomly 20% of the nodes. So what it does is, at every iteration, it will go through the neural network and it will randomly drop 20% of the nodes. So say in my case, I have 5 nodes, right? So if I keep dropout equals to 20%, what it will do is it will drop 20% of 5 nodes. So it will randomly drop one node out of this layer. So same thing it will do for every layer. So that's the reason we get different accuracy in different epochs. Yeah, that is also one of the reason you will get different accuracy in different epoch or even iteration. So because your neural network is not getting stabilized, you are actually disturbing the neural network as a lot. This is like, again, adding the noise part we have discussed, if you remember, right? What we are trying to do is, we are not trying to stabilize the neural network. So that way your ball will not get stuck in local minima. It will go to a better global minima. So similar to how mini batch gradient descent helps, right? Dropout kind of regularization also adds that amount of noise to your neural network so that it will not get settled in one point. It will try and go and reach a better position every time. You are pushing it, or the dropout is pushing it to achieve a better position in life. Did I miss any question? No. So There is another analogy of how dropout works like. So you can think of like in one iteration, there is one neural network here. If you consider, I mean, if you forget the drop nodes, right, whatever existing nodes, it will look like one neural network. In the next iteration, it will look like another neural network because another set of nodes are dropped, right? So because of this, it is like, I mean, you are having a different neural network every time, different structure every time, right? So that is how it looks like. Every iteration, it looks like a different neural network. There is a different structure because different nodes are randomly dropped every time. So just because of that, what happens is it is like a lot of neural networks working together for you. This is called as ensembling, when you have a lot of things working together to solve the same thing, task. So during training, we do dropping of these nodes, but when we are testing the neural network on image data set, right, we don't do this dropping. During testing, all the nodes will be there. Only during training, we do this so that it learns better. But during testing on our test data set, right, any test data set or any other image, we want to see if it is performing better or not. So what you do is you keep all the nodes. You don't drop any node. Dropout is applicable only during training. So because at the testing time, all the nodes are there, right? So it behaves like a lot of neural networks are working together for you. Because in the iteration, you have this kind of, iteration one, you have this kind of structure. In iteration two, you have another kind of structure. So a different kind of neural network is present across every iteration. But at the test time, all these neural networks are present together at the same time. So it is like a lot of neural networks trying to work together to give you the best accuracy possible, right? Is this analogy clear? The ensemble analogy? Yeah, so that is how you can treat dropout as. Dropout is considered as like you are having a lot of neural networks which are together working for you to solve the same task. At the testing time, you don't drop any nodes. That's why all the different kinds of structures that you see at training time, right? Everything will be there at testing time. Is the overfitting very common? Yes, it is pretty common. In every, almost every task, you will see overfitting. So you need to combat it. So that is one of the major tasks of any deep learning engineer. And that is one of the tasks I used to do a lot of time during my work at Samsung. So my task is to make that training accuracy and test accuracy as close to each other as possible. Because generally you will see that training accuracy will be very high and testing accuracy will be little bit low. So you try to improve your testing accuracy so that it will perform better on data that it has not seen. And also why it is very common, it is because these neural networks are very heavy. They have a lot of weights. They have very high capacity. Because they have this high capacity, they can actually just remember all the inputs that you have provided. That's why overfitting is very common. And we need these regularization techniques to combat the overfitting. So I have talked about only one overfitting technique, dropout, but there are many other overfitting techniques also. We'll talk about them at a later point of time. So is this clear? What is dropout? And how it behaves in training time, testing time, and how it is helping you. Great. So I'll show the code for dropout as well, so that you can use it in your neural network. So yeah, I have commented out the dropout part if you see, right, but you can add the dropout layer as well. So when you do the dropout layer, what it does is out of the number of hidden nodes, when you say 0.2, it will drop 20% of the nodes randomly. So I have not kept dropout, but you can keep dropout everywhere. You don't drop nodes from the output, that doesn't make any sense. You need all the output nodes, but apart from that, you can drop any node in the hidden layers. You can't drop input and output nodes, because that means if you drop input nodes, that means you're losing out on information. If you drop output nodes, you're not getting all the outputs. So you don't drop them, but you drop any of the hidden layer nodes. So it need not be added in all layer. So that is something you can test it out as well. So I'm glad you're asking all these questions. These are all very important questions. So you need not add it in every layer. You can actually add it in few layers and see which one is giving better results. So that is a hyperparameter as well, where you want to add it. And similarly, another hyperparameter is how much dropout to keep. So should I drop 20% of the nodes or should I drop 40% of the nodes? That is something you can experiment with as well. So yeah, try out all these things. Keep dropout in few layers. Don't keep dropout in other layers. Experiment with how much dropout you need to keep. Keep high values, keep low values, see which one is giving better results.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, can I speak for a while?
Yeah, sure.
See, you have added the activation layer, right? Below the dense layer. Hello.
I have added. I have added activation layer.
So the thing is, we can directly pass the activation argument in the dense layer itself, right? I don't think there is a need to add.
Yeah, you can absolutely do that. Yeah, I just kept it to make the representation simpler, but you can actually keep the argument directly in the dense layer. That would be make the code much less, but I just made it so that everything is visible here, how it would look like.
Okay, fine, thanks.
But yeah, you are absolutely right. Okay, yeah. You can add the, there is an argument which you can pass to the dense layer, which says that what activation should be used in this particular layer before going to the next. If you do that, you don't need to add this. So yeah, valid point. Thanks, Keras. Okay, so I'll share the notebook. As I said, you try out all the things that we have discussed so far and see which one is giving you the better results, and share on WhatsApp group so that everyone knows what is the progress that is happening. So we'll get started with CNN. I guess, I hope, if you have any doubts, you can ask right now or we can get started with CNN. Someone was asking, can we have this document? So I'm actually sharing the document every time. So the MD file, Markdown file. Only thing is, it is not pretty visible in Notepad or something like that. So you need a client like Typora to make it look, or you can actually see some in something like a GitHub or something to make the presentation look like this. But yeah, otherwise on Notepad, you'll only see text, you will not see images. You can install this Typora client. It is present in every OS. So you can just install it and you open the Markdown file with that. That would actually make you, get you all the illustrations. Okay, if you want me to share the Typora link, I'll share that, sure. So yeah, someone is asking, Jashandeep Singh is asking, like, do excess dropout leads to more time? Yeah, true. So if you add a very high amount of dropout, right? So it makes the network take a lot of time to train because there are very less number of nodes, right? So it will train slowly. So instead of like getting 88% in the first epoch, you'll be getting something like 40% in the first epoch, and then 45%, 50%, like that, it will take more time. So 20 epochs might not be enough. You might need to train for 50 epochs or 100 epochs to reach that good amount of accuracy. Cool. So let's get started with CNN. So yeah, ANNs are all good. They are able to like solve the task of MNIST, but they're only good till there. As then when you go to any other task, right? They are very heavy. So since they are very heavy, the computation goes out of your hand. Another thing is they are not giving good results. There are multiple reasons as to why they are not giving good results. So we'll talk about them, but yeah, they are not giving industry quality results. So these are the two main reasons why people wanted to move away from ANN. And they have tried for a new architecture, which will give better results, and then came CNN. So what CNN does is, it will try to rectify the problems that a artificial neural network had. So it does this by doing by gathering information in the 2D space rather than 1D space. So what I mean by gathering information in the 2D space rather than in a 1D space. So you know, image is 2D, right? So it is having a width and height. But what we have done in case of artificial neural network, we have converted it into a 1D vector. How we have done that? We have taken every pixel value as a neuron and we have created a 784 dimensional 1D vector. So when we did that, we lost all the spatial information. By spatial information, what I meant is, so if you consider an image, right? Say for example, let me type it out in the chat box. So say my image is this. So say my image is this 3x3. Oh, sorry. Right? So this is my image. So I'm having 9 pixels. Since it is a 3x3 resolution image, right? So when I convert it into 1D, what happens is I'll be getting an output like this. Right, so this is how you convert a 2D image into a 1D vector. So you take all the pixels and you go from row to row and add all these values into a 1D vector. This is how you provide input to the neural network. So it will have 9 nodes of which you will take all the inputs of all the pixels. This is how you convert a 2D image into a 1D image. So what is the problem with this? Can someone tell what is the problem by converting into this? Can someone guess what could have been the problem that occurred because of doing this kind of a thing?
Hello.
This is a, yeah, sure.
We are still seeing your Typora screen. I think you are not showing the right screen.
No, I have typed it on the chat box.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, in the chat box I have mentioned I have an image of 3x3. So it has 9 values. So 9 pixels, 139426 and 744. So this is a 3x3 resolution image. I have converted it into a 1D vector. So what is the problem with this? We have lost 2 axes. So if we have lost 2 axes, what is the problem with that? We are still able to provide the input, right? What did it cause any problem? Converting this kind of a structure to 1D structure. Converting this 2D structure into 1D structure, if we do this, have we lost something? So someone is saying more number of input layers. Yeah, you can think of it like more number of input layers, but still that doesn't actually is a problem sort of. Yeah, so what we have lost is the spatial info. We have lost the spatial info. By spatial info, what we mean is like previously, if you see, right, in an image, pixels which are close to each other, they carry some kind of closureness in how they look. So say you are having a picture of a baby or a picture of a person, and in that picture there are hands. So if you see pixels which are close to each other in that hand, right, so these are both of them will actually look almost similar. Two pixels which are very close, which are nearby, right, they almost look similar. So they have this kind of information that all the things that are very close to each other, right? All the pixels which are very close to each other, they almost look the same. And this kind of spatial information, the 2D information that is present, right? We lost it when we have converted it into a 1D vector. So how we have lost it? So we know that pixels which are close to each other actually have some information together. They are kind of similar. That's what we have seen. So when we converted into 1D, what happened is the horizontal pixels are still actually fine. They are still close to each other. So pixel 2 and pixel 1 are in the same position. But what we have lost is the vertical dimension. So what happened is the fourth pixel and the first pixel, I mean the first pixel in the first row and the first pixel in the second row, they're not together anymore. We have split it across, right? So we have lost that spatial information. So what I'm saying is you can actually look into the matrix that I have provided. In the matrix that I have provided, so the first pixel in the first row is value 1 and the first pixel in the second row is value 4. They're not adjacent anymore. I mean, first pixel is present in one place and the first pixel in the second row is present in some other place, the 1D vector, right? So we have lost that kind of vertical spatial information. We only have the horizontal spatial information. So when you have lost that kind of information, right, neural network has no way to identify, okay, these pixels are closely related to each other, right? So that is the problem with converting a 2D image to a 1D image. I'm not seeing any GIF as such. I'm only actually showing the chat box. There is no chat box. Oh, sorry, there is no GIF. I have not changed anything. I'm only talking about the values that I have provided. Is this clear why actually we have lost information when we converted a 2D matrix into a 1D vector? We have lost the vertical information, right? So the pixels which are close to each other in the column axis have no way of saying that they are close to each other when you convert it into a 1D dimension, right? Is that clear, that part? What we have lost when we have converted a 2D image into a 1D vector? Yeah, so it feels like only the horizontal pixels are together. The vertical pixels are nowhere close to each other. So it's like pixels are randomly given as inputs, almost. Not exactly, but to some extent. So you only have the horizontal spatial information. You don't have the vertical spatial information. So that is the problem with artificial neural network. So you are losing that vertical spatial information. CNN solves this problem by dealing with not 1D vector. It will directly deal with the 2D image itself. So that is why CNN is going to be better than artificial neural network, because it captures both the horizontal information and it will capture the vertical information as well, right? So before going into what convolution and things like that are, I'll just show you a video that will give you an understanding of how any neural network kind of behaves, and we will see that it is pretty important for us in our understanding of a neural network.
Let's just talk about why it's even reasonable to expect a layered structure like this to behave intelligently. What are we expecting here? What is the best hope for what those middle layers might be doing? Well, when you or I recognize digits, we piece together various components. A 9 has a loop up top and a line on the right. An 8 also has a loop up top, but it's paired with another loop down low. A 4 basically breaks down into 3 specific lines and things like that. Now, in a perfect world, we might hope that each neuron in the second to last layer corresponds with one of these subcomponents. That anytime you feed in an image with, say, a loop up top, like a 9 or an 8, there's some specific neuron whose activation is going to be close to 1. And I don't mean this specific loop of pixels. The hope would be that any generally loopy pattern towards the top sets off this neuron. That way, going from the third layer to the last one just requires learning which combination of subcomponents corresponds to which digits. Of course, that just kicks the problem down the road, because how would you recognize these subcomponents or even learn what the right subcomponents should be? And I still haven't even talked about how one layer influences the next, but run with me on this one for a moment. Recognizing a loop can also break down into subproblems. One reasonable way to do this would be to first recognize the various little edges that make it up. Similarly, a long line, like the kind you might see in the digits 1 or 4 or 7, well, that's really just a long edge, or maybe you think of it as a certain pattern of several smaller edges. So maybe Our hope is that each neuron in the second layer of the network corresponds with the various relevant little edges. Maybe when an image like this one comes in, it lights up all of the neurons associated with around 8 to 10 specific little edges, which in turn lights up the neurons associated with the upper loop and a long vertical line, and those light up the neuron associated with a 9. Whether or not this is what our final network actually does is another question, one that I'll come back to once we see how to train the network. But this is a hope that we might have, a sort of goal with the layered structure like this. Moreover, you can imagine how being able to detect edges and patterns like this would be really useful for other image recognition tasks. And even beyond image recognition.
Yeah, so what we have seen is what is our intuition of how a neural network might be learning to classify any digit. So what we are thinking is it will not directly take the image and say that, okay, this is a particular digit. It will try to break it into subtasks. Subtask could be like identifying a small edge, small line or something like that. So probably the previous, I mean, the starting layers are doing with identifying these smaller components of lines and edges, which are actually used to fit small shapes like a bigger line or a circle kind of thing in the next layer. And all this information is probably used at the final layer to determine whether it is which digit or not, right? So this is the kind of representation learning we are kind of expecting from a neural network in general. So this is what we expect, but what we see is in artificial neural network, it doesn't happen. In a CNN, it happens. So yeah, I just wanted to clear this part before we get started with how it works in a CNN. But yeah, this is how a neural network will actually proceed in kind of solving any particular task. It will try to divide it into smaller subtasks, which every layer will do, and every layer will pass this information to the next layer so that it can actually build on top of that one and do a bigger complex task, and at the end doing the complete task of whatever it is provided, like doing the classification in this sense. Is this clear how a neural network is kind of able to like break a bigger task into smaller tasks and divide it across the layers and do this?
Hello,
kind of
we cannot see your screen again.
Yeah, I'm not sharing the screen anything yet. So I just showed the YouTube video. I guess you have seen the YouTube video, I guess, right? I'm just actually. I showed a YouTube video. I hope everyone has seen that. I mean, yeah. So, yeah, I already shared it, but in case you had not seen it, that's why I have wanted to show that those 3 minutes. So, those 3 minutes represent how a neural network is supposed to learn. ANN doesn't do that. We'll see that across. So, what it does is it tries to divide a bigger task into smaller tasks, which can be used to do the task of classification. That part is clear, right? Okay, great. So yeah, we'll get started with the terms that are required for a convolutional neural network. So the basic important term that is involved when doing when you are talking about convolutional neural network, again, is as it is present in the name, it is convolution. Convolution is an operation of having a matrix multiplying with another matrix and getting an output. This is the basic convolution. Although the convolution in the sense of say electrical engineering or something is different, in the terms of deep learning, it is nothing but doing a matrix dot product and getting an output. That is what convolution is. So in this case, you can see that there is a image of size 5x5, right? So think of the blue boundary that is present. Think of it like as an image of size 5x5. So what you are doing is you are multiplying it with another matrix of size 3x3. So this is the filter sort of. So I'll talk what a filter is, but what we are doing is we are multiplying this entire box with a filter. So filter is another matrix. So we are multiplying this 5x3 matrix with a 3x3 matrix. So what we do is we start with a 3x3 position of in the 5x5 entire matrix. In the entire 5x5 matrix, we start with from the left and find out what are the first 3x3 pixels present, and we try to find out the dot product. So when you do a dot product of one 3x3 matrix with another 3x3 matrix, right, you'll be getting a single value. Then you move this 3x3 matrix to the right and again do the convolution. Convolution is again what you have said is dot product. So you'll get another value and you continue this process until you reach the end. So once you reach the end, what you do is, okay, I have reached the end of the column. So what I will do is I'll move to the bottom, again come to the leftmost bottom, and again I'll do the repeat the process. I'm actually explaining what is happening in the GIF right now. So what we are doing is we are having an image and we are convoluting with a matrix across all the positions that are present in an image. So we are starting with the leftmost position until we reach the rightmost. Once we reach the rightmost, we come down a little bit and again we start at the leftmost and we continue this process until we complete the entire image, right? So when you are convoluting a 5x5 image with a 3x3 filter, what you are getting at the output is a 3x3 matrix. This is the convolution part. So matrix dot product, everyone is clear, I guess, right? So it is nothing but what happens is if you have a 3x3 matrix of or I'll just say 2x2 matrix. I'm trying to give an example. So I have matrix M1 of size 2x2. So its values are 1, 2, 3, 4. And say I have another matrix of size 2x2, which is having values 2, 3, 4, 5. So if I do the dot product of them directly, right, I'll be getting 1. 1 into 2 plus 2 into 3 plus 3 into 4 plus 4 into 5. This is the value you will be getting. You will be getting a single value. So when you are doing a dot product of 2x2 matrix 1, 2, 3, 4 with 2, 3, 4, 5, right? What you are getting is 1 into 2. When you multiply every pixel with the corresponding pixel in the same position in the other matrix. And by pixel mean, I mean position. So I take the element which is present at the leftmost and multiply it with the leftmost value in the next matrix. So I'll multiply 1 with 2 and then I multiply 2 with 3 and multiply 3 with 4 and 4 with 5. This is the dot product. This part is clear, right? How you are actually getting the dot product of two matrices. You are taking each value from one matrix and multiplying with another value. Yeah, it is kind of matrix multiplication, but you don't do the direct matrix multiplication. Matrix multiplication, you know that it will, you will multiply a row with a column, right? Here we are actually multiplying each value with another value in the same position. So it's not a matrix multiplication, it's a dot product. So you are taking a value at every position and multiplying with a value at similar position in the other matrix. So say I'm taking the element at 0th row and 0th column in matrix 1, right? So I'm multiplying with the element at 0th row and 0th column in matrix 2. And that is what I am getting as the value. So when I start here, so what is the element that is present at the 0th row and 0th column in first matrix? It is 1. So I took 1. What is the element present at 0th row and 0th column in matrix 2? That is 2. So that's why I have 1x2. I mean 1 into 2 in the first value. So similarly, I say what is the value that is present at 0th row and first column in the first matrix? That is 2. What is the element that is present at 0th row and first column in second matrix? That is 3. So that's why I got 2x2 into 3. Similarly, I do for the other elements as well. So I got 3 into 4 and 4 into 5. Once I got these values, I sum up all of them. I'll be getting a single value. So when I do a matrix dot product of two matrices of the same size, right, you'll be getting a single value. Is this clear how we are doing the dot product of two matrices? Same thing happens for 3x3 or 5x5 or any kind of matrices. So same thing you can see in this figure as well. So you have a 3x3 matrix. You start at the leftmost position in this 5x5 matrix and you take a 3x3 chunk. You don't take the entire 5x5 matrix, but you only take the 3x3 chunk starting from the leftmost position, leftmost and topmost position. So you get a 3x3 matrix, right? When you do the multiplication, what you get is a single value. That is what is the white box that is coming here, right? So you get a single value. Then you shift the matrix a little bit to the right by 1 pixel and you do the same operation again. You get another value. Again, you shift, you get another value. Now the columns are done. So what you do is you come a row down and you again start from the first column and you repeat this process across. This is the entire process of convoluting a filter with an image. So I'll talk what is a filter, but yeah, think of filter as another matrix. Image is a matrix. So you are convolving two matrices of different size. What it means is you take the smaller matrix, you start at the top leftmost, and you try to move it across until you complete the entire image across both the horizontal and vertical directions. So that's why when you are convoluting an image of size 5x5 with 3x3, right, you are getting an output of 3x3. Is this clear how convolution is working? So convolution is the multiplication of a bigger filter with a bigger matrix with a smaller matrix. You can think of it like that at this point of time. Is this clear, or do you want me to repeat, or something is not very clear? Because this is the fundamental concept which is present in convolution. And until and unless you understand this, it doesn't make sense to know about convolutional neural networks. Right? How about others? Is this part clear? How we are actually doing this matrix multiplication? Okay, great. So why are we doing this? We are doing this because I'll tell why we are doing this. It has a specific use case in convolutional neural network, but I'm trying to explain how we do this before I tell why we do this. So which two matrices are getting multiplied at a time? So the filter that is used to actually multiply, right, it is not very visible. So, but I can show you how it works. So say I have a matrix of size 3x3, right? I want to convolve it a matrix of size 2x2. Right? So how am I going to deal with this? So what I will do is, I'll start at the leftmost position of the biggest matrix. So the biggest matrix in this case is the 3x3 matrix, right? So what is the leftmost position? It is value 1. From there, I try to see what is the 2x2 matrix that I can get. So what is the 2x2 matrix that I can get from that position? Can someone type? What is the 2x2 matrix that I can get when I'm standing at the leftmost position in the 3x3 matrix? Yeah, exactly. So what you get is 1, 2, 4, 5, right? So you do a matrix multiplication of 1, 2, 4, 5 with your filter, which is this, in the case 1, 2, 3, 1. So when you do matrix dot product, right, what you will be getting? So can someone take what is the value that you will be getting? If I'm doing dot product between these two matrices, right, what is the value that I'll be getting? Yeah, so that is the value that I'm getting. So he has written a constraint version. So what we are doing is, we are trying to multiply elements at the same position. So we are doing 1 into 1 plus 2 into 2 plus 4 into 3 plus 5 into 1. That is how we got the value that he has mentioned. So you'll be getting 4 plus 2, 16 plus 5, 21 plus 1, 22. 22 value you'll be getting. So this is the output that I'm getting at the leftmost position. Once I have got the value at the leftmost position, right? So what I do is, I'll try to shift a bit to the right. So if I shift from there to the right by 1 pixel, right, what is the 2x2 matrix that I'll get? So instead of standing at 1 now, now I'm standing at 2 in the 3x3 matrix. Standing at 2, what is the 2x2 matrix that I'll be getting? Can someone type? If, yeah, 2352 is the matrix that you'll be getting, right? So this is the matrix I'm getting when I'm standing at position 2. Again, I'll do the convolution with the 1, 2, 3, 1. So I'll be getting some value. Take that value. So now we have reached the end of the columns, right? So what we need to do is, you again need to come back to the next row and start at the first column. So if I am standing at the first row, but at the zeroth column, right? So what is the value that I'll be getting? What is the 2x2 matrix at starting from first row and zeroth column. Zeroth column, I mean, is the starting position. So if you're starting at first row and zeroth column, what is the, okay, not zero, is I should say second row and first column. Yeah. If you are in the second row, so there are three rows, right? So if you are at the second row and you are standing in the first column, so what is the 2x2 matrix you will get? Yeah, exactly. So what you will get is 4, 5, 6, 2. So yeah, exactly. So you get 4, 5, 6, 2. You again do the convolution with 1, 2, 3, 1. You will get some value. Now again you move to the right. Again you will get 5, 2, 2, 1. And again you do convolution. You will get some value. Again you will reach the boundary. Again you will come down. There is nothing to come down. So you are done actually. Because there is no row below it, right? So you are done. That, so you are getting a 2x2 output, right? Because you got values from four positions. Is this clear how we have done the matrix computation of a 3x3 matrix with a 2x2 matrix? Great. So the same thing is happening in the figure here as well. Yeah, in this case, 1, 2, 3, 1 is the filter. The smaller one. So the same thing is happening in the GIF as well, if you see. So you are having 5x5 and you are having a 3x3 matrix, which is starting from the leftmost position and it is slowly going across. So that is how you do the matrix convolution. So what we are doing is we are multiplying an image by something called as filter. So I'll tell what is filter and how do we decide filters is something which the neural network learns by itself. So I'll talk about that as well. But before that, I just wanted to say, if you are taking 5x5 input, when you're convolving with a 3x3 filter, you'll get an output of 3x3, similar to what we have seen here, right? Because you're starting from one position and doing the convolution across. So you're starting with 5x5, if you're doing the convolution of 3x3 filter, you'll be getting an output of 3x3. Just like we have seen that, we took a 3x3 matrix and if we did a convolution with 2x2, right? What we got is a 2x2 output. So similarly, if you take a 5x5 input and you convolve it with a 3x3 filter, you'll be getting a 3x3 output. Similarly, you take an n cross n input, n can be anything, and you convolve it with a 3x3 filter, the output you'll be getting will be n-2 × n-2. This is a formula kind of thing. You can remember. So for 5x5, it will be 5-2 × 5-2. So it will be 3x3. If it is 7x7, you will be getting 7-2 × 7-2, so it will be 5x5, right? Similarly, if you are doing with the filter of 5x5, so we have seen the filter is 3x3, but it can be bigger also. So if you are doing with a bigger filter like 5x5, you will be getting an output of size n-4 × n-4. So if your input is say 11x11 and you are convolving with the filter of 5x5, your output will be 7x7. This kind of formula you can use. So as you increase the size, your output will kind of decrease as your filter size increases. Yeah, it should be a square filter. You only use a square filter in deep learning. And also you generally use odd sized filters. You don't use 2x2 or 4x4 or 6x6. You generally use 3x3, 5x5, 6, 7x7. And why do we do this? We do this because the output, right? In general, it should be even. So if you are having 28 pixels, right? If you are doing a convolution with 3x3, it will become 26x26. So again, it is even. But if you do with convolution with an even filter, right? You will get an odd output. You don't want that in general. So that's why you actually always try to keep an odd convolution filter. And the output that you are getting after you are doing a convolution with the input, right? That is called as a feature map. We'll talk about all these things in more detail, but yeah, these are the names that are used. So let's discuss what a filter is. So the task of a filter is to find out specific information that is present in the particular locality, right? So what a filter does is it will try to see if there is a particular edge or there is a particular shape or kind of a thing that is present at a particular locality. So we have seen that in the neural network video that I have shown, right? So we are expecting the neural network to find edges at the beginning. So the edges can be like a curve edge or like a little bit straight edge or something like that, right? So we are trying expecting the neural network to do that. So the task of the filter is that only. So it will go across all the image and it will see where that kind of H is present. If it is present, it will output a higher value. If it is not present, it will not output a higher value. So this is the task of a filter. The task of a filter is to find out edges or shapes or gradients or parts or something like that. So that is the task of a filter. So this is, if you see this filter, right? It is doing something called as edge detection. So if you pass this 3x3 matrix across an image, so this image can be anything. It can be 100x100. But when you are convolving with a 3x3 filter like this, right, you are getting an output like this. So it is finding out all the edges that are present and it is highlighting them at the output, right? So this is what this filter is doing. So there could be another filter which can do another task. So this filter is actually sharpening the entire image and making it look more clear, you can say, more sharper rather than the input image which is blur. So the task of a filter is multiple things. It can either find out edge, or it can find shape, or it can actually find some texture. By texture, what I mean is like color or those kind of information, or like what is the gradient. I mean, what is the surface looking like? Is it looking like brown or is it looking like gray or something like that? And how much coarse it is, how much sharp it is, those all kinds of information edges can learn. So different edges can learn different kind of things. So you will have multiple filters to do multiple tasks. Yeah, so these filters, right? These are actually learned by the neural network. Just like, I mean, these filters you can think of like weights only. So we have seen what are weights in fully connected neural network, right? In the case of CNN, you don't have weights like fully connected weights that are present, because we don't convert it into a 1D vector. Instead of that one, you have this matrix. So you can think of all the values that are present in this matrix, this filter, right, as weights only. So you are using these weights to find out a particular specific information that is present in the image. So this is what a filter does. So filter can do many kinds of things. So it can do these things in the chronological order. So the filters that are present at the beginning layers, right? So it will try to find out the edges. The filters that are present at the later layers, it will try to find out shapes. So we saw edges is something like a small curve or a small line or something like that. Shape is like a circle or a straight line or square, those kind of things. Texture is, again, we have seen what is the surface looking like. Parts of objects is like, say if you are having a human present, right? So it can actually detect what are the parts that are present. So there are two eyes, one nose, human face I'm talking about. So a filter can do that as well, but it can do that at the final layers based on the information that is present on the previous layers. And at the final layer, you will try to see what are all the objects that are present in the image. So if there is a person, there is a dog, there is a cat. So this is the chronological order of what the filters does on a layer to layer basis. We saw that in the video that I have shown, that initial layers will try to learn the low level information, the low level information being edges, shapes, those kind of information. But the later layers learn the higher kind of information, like finding out what are the parts of objects and similarly what are all the objects that are present. Is this clear how a neural network learns in general? Great. So yeah, these filters, right? Again, these filters, you can see that this filter is actually capturing the 2D information. It is not, since this is also a 2D matrix, right? It is capturing the 2D information in a 3x3 location. Every 3x3 location, it is trying to see if some particular edge was there or not. That's why it is actually better than a artificial neural network, because it has no sense of that 2D structure, right? But since we are using a 2D matrix to convolve and find out if there is an edge or not, right? So that's why this CNN has more sense of the spatial information compared to an artificial neural network. So I hope the filter kernel part is clear. Also, one more thing, why CNN is better than ANN is because this weight, right? It is shared across all the image. So what I mean by shared is you don't have a different filter for every location. We are just actually moving the filter across all the locations, if you see, right? In the figure I have shown. in this G5 we have seen, right? We are actually not having a different weight matrix for every location. Instead of that one, we are just having a single matrix and we are convolving it across the location. That is why the number of weights will be much lesser. But in the case of ANN, we see that we are actually having different weights for different locations, which is not good. That is why CNN is much lighter than ANN. And also CNN has very good properties that since we are actually moving a filter across the image to find out where that particular required information is present, right? Irrespective of where that information is present, we can go and find it. So that is very good, right? So for example, I wanted to find where is a cat present in an image. So I can see whether it is present at the if it is present at the top left corner or if it is present at the bottom right corner, anywhere it is present in the image, I can go and find, okay, there is a cat present in the image. But if you want a fully connected neural network to do that, right? So you should have weights at every location to detect whether the cat is present or not. So that will actually is a difficult thing. So you are actually making it complex for a neural network. That way CNN works better because we are actually going and finding out where it is present. In ANN, what happens is we are only using the weights that are present in that portion. We are actually having a detector to detect whether there is a cat or not, right? So we are trying to say that every neuron should detect whether there is a cat or present or not in that location. So it is like making the task of a network very complex. You can think of it like that case. So maybe to make it more clear, you can look at this image. So if the cat is present at this rightmost position, right, all these neurons should be able to detect that there is a cat. But if the cat is present at the leftmost position, all these neurons have to detect there is a cat, right? So you are asking every neuron that is present in the fully connected neural network to detect whether there is a cat or not. So neurons don't have specific distinction that, okay, you find out if there is a cat or not. I'll try to find out if there is a dog or not. Every neuron is trying to do every other task. Right, so it is kind of becoming very complex. In this case of a CNN, we don't do that. What we do is we specify particular task to particular filter. One filter will go and see if there is a cat or not. Another filter will go and see whether there is a dog or not. That kind of thing is there. So that's why CNN is much better than ANN. So these are the reasons why CNN is better than ANN. So someone is saying is segmentation is possible in CNN. Yeah, segmentation is a use case of CNN. Yeah, in CNN there is no graph structure because we saw that in fully connected neural network you need to have a connection with every other neuron. Here we don't do that. We have a filter which convolves with all the input image. So you will have multiple filters to do multiple tasks. Every filter does a different task. So one will try to find one edge, another will try to find another edge, those kind of things. So you'll have multiple filters which convolve with the image. You will get another output, and in the next layer you repeat it. So I'll show what is the general structure of a neural network, convolutional neural network. So this is the structure of a convolutional neural network. You have an input which you convolve with a set of features, and what you will be getting is a set of feature maps. So when you convolve an input with a feature map, right, with a filter, when you are convolving an input with a filter, you are getting one feature map. And we saw that there can be multiple filters, right? Every filter is trying to do a particular task. So since there are multiple filters, you'll be getting multiple outputs. And again, you repeat this task. Again, there will be another set of filters which will try to convolve on top of this one to find out the higher information across. So we saw that deep learning works with representational learning. That means initial layers try to find out edges. The other layers try to find out the better things like shapes and similarly textures, gradients, and all those things. So based on the information that is coming from the previous layer, the next layer tries to find out higher information again by doing the same process of convolution. So this continues until your output is less, and I'll tell how you actually convert to get the output. So yeah, I'll talk about what is pooling. But before that, I wanted to be clear that CNN is. I wanted to confirm if the convolution part is clear. Yeah, someone is asking, in the image, edges are convolved only once. It may lead to loss of information in some edges. So why it will lead to loss of information? because so there are multiple filters to do multiple tasks, right? So every filter will go across the image and see if the information required for that is required there or not. If it is there, it will give a high value. If it is not there, it will give a low value. So it will give a feature map. So there are multiple filters, so you'll be getting multiple feature maps at the output. So yeah, I am not exactly sure if I understood your question. Do you want to ask again? Did I miss something? Krishna? So there is generally no loss of information because you will have multiple edges to capture multiple information. So multiple filters to capture multiple information. So once you have this information, you'll be getting a feature map. And using this feature map, the next layer will try to capture the higher information. So if the first layer is capturing the edges, second layer will capture the shapes, the third layer will capture the texture, fourth layer will capture the object, parts of objects, and similarly, fifth layer will probably capture the objects, entire objects. That is how CNN works. So, yeah, feature map is the output that you get when you convolve an input with a filter. So we saw that when you convolve a 5x5 matrix with a filter, right, you get a 3x3 output. So that 3x3 output is nothing but a feature map, right? So we saw that there can be actually multiple filters to do a particular different task. So when you convolve an input of when you convolve an input with multiple filters, you'll be getting multiple outputs, right? So that's why you have multiple feature maps, and then you continue this process again, information, and you go on until you reach the output layer. So this is what a feature map is. So generally you will see that you do 3x3 convolution. People tried 5x5 convolution and 7x7 convolution as well, but what they have seen is you don't need a 5x5 or 7x7 convolution in general, because it will have more number of parameters. Instead of that one, instead of having 5x5 convolution doing at the same time, I can do 2 3x3 convolutions one after another. Right, so how they are similar. So if you remember, right, we saw that if you are having an n cross n image and passing it through 5x5 filter, you are getting an output n-4 × n-4, right? This is what we have seen. And we saw that if you have an n cross n image and you are passing it through a 3x3 filter, you will get n-2 × n-2, right? So say I am actually passing it instead of through a 1x1 through a 3x3 filter once, I'll pass it to 2 3x3 filter in 2 different layers. I mean, in the first layer, I'll pass it through 1 3x3 filter. In the second layer, I will pass it through another 3x3 filter. So what is the output I'll get? n×n. If I pass it through 2 consecutive 3x3 layers, right? What is the output I'll get? No. So n×n. If I'm passing it through 3x3, I'll get n-2 × n-2. Right? So instead of that one, I mean, after this, the input will be, I mean, the feature map size will be n×2 – n-2 × n-2, right? So now I am passing it to 3x3 again. What is the output I am getting? So what is the output I'll get now? n-4 × n-4, right? So this is same as passing it through 5x5 directly, right? Because if I pass it through 5x5, I'm getting n-4 × n-4 directly, right? So you can think of doing 3x3 convolutions one after the other as similar to doing a single 1x5 convolution. Is that clear? Great. So that way you can represent any convolution by using only 3x3 layer. Okay, yeah, so I'll explain again. So what I'm saying is you have an input of size n×n. If you pass it through a filter of size 5x5, right, what is the output you'll be getting? You'll be getting n-4 × n-4. This is what we have seen already, right? Using the formula that is already present. So the thing is, instead of like passing it through a single one, 5x5, what we can do is we can pass it through 2 consecutive to 3x3. So if I pass n cross n to 3x3, right, what is the output I'll be getting? I'll be getting n minus 2 cross n minus 2, right? I'll take this output and I'll pass it through another 3x3 in the next layer, right? If I do that, what is the output I'll get? Output size I'll be getting? So yeah, what is the output size I'll be getting? N minus 4 cross n minus 4, exactly, right? So these are equivalent. So like passing a single 5x5 convolution or passing 2 3x3 convolutions in 2 different layers consecutively is kind of similar. So is that clear, Krishna? Like how we are actually kind of saying that you can actually represent a 5x5 convolution by 2 3x3 convolutions consecutively? Great. Yeah, I'll just briefly explain what is pooling so that you get an understanding of. Yeah, what pooling does is there is something called as max pool. What it does is it will divide this entire matrix into blocks of 2x2, and it will try to find out what is the highest value in this. So if you take a 4x4 matrix, right, max pool, what it does is it will try to find out what is the highest value in the first block. In the first block, you have out of these values 12, 20, 8, 12, right? What is the highest value? 20. So it picks that value. Then it goes to the next block and it finds out what is the highest value. In this, the highest value is 30, so it picks that. Similarly, you have another one in this blue block. What is the highest value? 112. In the green block, what is the highest value? 37. So that way we have converted a 4x4 matrix into a 2x2 matrix. That is what max pooling does. What max pooling does is it tries to find out what is the most prominent feature that is present. So why it does this? Why we use max pool? We use it because we wanted to reduce the size of the input. So if you don't reduce the size of input, right? So say your image is having size 300x300. So if you use a convolution of 3x3, we know that the 300x300 will become 298x298. But we need to go until it becomes 1x1. That is at the output. At the output, we'll be having only one value, right? So you need to do 3x3 convolution, and another layer you again do 3x3 convolution. So 300x300 will become 298x298, and then again it will become 296x296. You continue this until you make the size smaller that you reach the output layer, right? So you can see it needs 150 convolution layers to make the output to make the input of size 300x300 a single output. With pooling, you can actually fast track it. So if you pass a 300x300 input to a pooling, right, you will directly get 75x75. If you pass it to convolution, you get 298x298. You only reduce it by 2 pixels, but pooling reduces it by half the number of pixels. So that is why pooling is required, because if we want those many 150 number of convolutions, right, it is like we are having those many number of filters. So that will become make the network very huge. You don't want to have those many number of filters. That's why you use pooling to reduce the number of layers. So I think, we do lose information in pooling. So that is a problem with pooling. If you do pooling, whenever you do pooling, you lose information. But since we are taking the maximum prominent feature, right, so the neural network learns that it will keep all the most prominent information that is required in that location, it will be able to take for doing whatever task it needs to do. So the task here is doing the task of classification, right? So it will take all the prominent information, it will ignore all the unnecessary information. So in an image, right, so to see if there is a dog or not, so probably some information is very important. If there is sky or those kind of information, right, that is not very required for doing the task of classification, whether there is a dog or not. So max pool will lose all those kind of unnecessary information and only keep the important information. So the important information will be like seeing if there is eyes of dogs present or if there is a nose of dog present or not. So these kind of information it will keep, and it will ignore all the unnecessary information that is needed. Yeah, so it will take the most effective features that are present. Yeah. That is what max pooling does. And why we use it? Because we wanted to reduce the size of the network. Otherwise, you need 150 convolutions to go to the output layer. So it takes a lot of time. We don't want to do that. That's why we use cooling. We'll talk more about it late tomorrow, I guess. But yeah, if you have any doubts, you can ask regarding the class. Yeah, we use it to speed up computation. Exactly. If you use 150 layers, it will take too much time till you reach the output. So any doubts in the things we have discussed so far? What is CNN? What is convolution? What is pooling? We'll talk more about the structure again tomorrow. But yeah, these are the basic components, convolution and pooling. So tomorrow we'll talk about the other things that are needed to complete the CNN part. Once that is done, we'll try to actually write a CNN as well. Not tomorrow. I think, I don't know when the next class is. Maybe in 2 days, I guess. So yeah, whenever that is there, we'll be talking about what are the other components that are present in a CNN. But these are the major two components. Apart from this, we will see what are the other things that are needed. And similarly, we'll try to write our first CNN. We have written our first ANN today. So we'll try to write our first CNN. So you get to experiment with that also. You try and see how much accuracy you can get. So you will see that actually it performs much better than MNIST. So MNIST gets, ANN. ANN gets stuck at max 97 or 98, but with CNN you can get 99.3, 99.5, something like that. So that is kind of possible. And in this case, since the task is very simple, that's why we are able to get 97% accuracy with ANN. But if you go for a better task, right? So like finding out if a dog is there or not, if you give it to ANN, it will give you 40% accuracy. But with CNN, you'll get still 95% accuracy. So that's why CNN is much better than ANN. Great. Any more questions? If not, we'll wrap up. Okay. I'll again share the WhatsApp group, I guess. Yeah, so this is the WhatsApp group link. So Krishna, you can join it. Similarly, if you have missed the classes, you can find the videos in the Board Infinity portal. Taipura, I'll just share the link. I'll share in WhatsApp, I guess. That would be more beneficial so anyone can install. I'll share the link in WhatsApp for Taipura. Great. I think we are done. Good night, everyone. We'll meet in the next class. Thanks.